Proverbs chapter 14. Every wise woman buildeth her house. Every wise woman. You know, when a woman goes into marriage, starts off with very little. Probably apartment, used furniture. And with time, if God gives time, that house ought to be grown. That house ought to be changed. It ought to be for the better. And with that verse, when we get to chapter 31, the virtuous woman, all that she does, and be amazing to see what she does. But the foolish, not the wise, the foolish plucketh it down with her hands. Now, Brother James said something interesting with this plucking when we talk about the Gospel of John. He says, you don't pluck a chicken when it's alive. You pluck it when it's dead. This foolish woman has a dead house, and she begins plucking it. Destroying. Complete opposite of the wise woman. He that walketh in his uprightness feareth the Lord. Now that's an Old Testament. We don't walk in our uprightness. We walk in the righteousness of Jesus Christ. So when you walk upright, you're fearing God. You're doing what he's told you to do. But he that is perverse, opposite of upright, in his ways, not God's ways, despises him, and him is God. When you are perverse and you walk in your own ways, you despise God. I don't care what you call yourself. I don't care who you say you are. The Bible is just as plain. As we talked about in chapter 13, 24, if you say you love your children, you don't chastise them, the Bible says you don't love them. When you direct your church the way you want it and not the way the Bible says, and your family, in the mouth of the foolish is a rod of pride. Uh-oh. Pride never goes with God. So you are against God. But the lips of the wise, opposite of the foolish, shall preserve them. Preserve who? People who you're talking to. People you are helping. Your own self. He thinks before he talks. Where no oxen are, the crib, that's the feeding place, the pen, where the oxen are kept, where no oxen are, don't you just love the Bible? Don't you just love how far and wide it is? Where no oxen are, the crib is clean. There's no manure. There's no food scattered all over the place. It's clean. But much increase. Crops. Much increase is by the strength of the oxen. The oxen is the product. You need the oxen to till the ground, to do the work. A faithful witness will not lie. Okay. But a false witness will utter lies. Isn't it just simple? You know, when Jesus was on trial before the Sanhedrin, there was just plenty of false witnesses, but no faithful witness. You notice that? Not a faithful witness stood up that you guys are liars. No. The false witnesses that uttered lies, their lies contradicted the other lies and stood as lies. They said, it says in the gospel that they couldn't agree with each other. That means the lies were so lyingful, so stupid, so pulled out of the hat that you couldn't get even two lies to agree with each other. A scorner, remember him from chapter 1? Seeketh wisdom and findeth it not. I don't think we're going to finish this chapter tonight, so it's a long one. Let me show you by illustration what this verse is by true life. A person comes up to you, he wants an answer. And you give him the answer. You open up the Bible and give him the answer. And why won't he get the answer? Well, you see, the Bible was written by man. Yeah? So what? Well, that's your opinion and other. See, the scorner, he wants to know, but he doesn't want to know. And he's not going to get the answer. He'll give you excuses. He'll give you contrast. He'll give you anything but an answer to what you've given him. And I've seen that. And I've worked with people on that. But knowledge is easy unto him that understandeth. When you got someone who will believe what God tells him and desires more from God, as long as he don't turn that switch off, you can teach that guy something and he'll learn more and more. There was a day, listen, I couldn't be able to go through Proverbs with you. There was a day maybe I couldn't even find the book of Proverbs. There was a day when I thought Job was the book of Job. And as I received the light that Christ has given me and trusted that light, I get more light. I know people who were saved right around my time to save, and they're just spiritual retard babies. If they're even still in the walk. Because they have not believed what God, and they've given a scorner answer. Go from the presence of a foolish man. Well, what's a foolish man? Take a concordance, find the word fool and everything that deals with foolish, and go through the book of Proverbs. As we go, we're 14 chapters now. Mark of the fool, we've talked about, and we've been talking about the fool much, and we got more to talk. You know, there's only one or two passages in Proverbs that speaks of a fool rightly. And everywhere else, the fool is a fool. Go from the presence of a foolish man. That's a command by the Bible. When you find out a guy in a pulpit is a fool, the Bible commands you to go from the presence. When you find that somebody that you're dealing with is a fool, you, by the Bible fool, you are commanded to get out of his way. When thou perceivest, when you are made aware, when you see, when thou perceivest not, in him the lips of knowledge. I have walked away from churches because of that verse right there. I've listened to that guy, and if you ask my family, I give him chance after chance, and this eventually, you know what? No. And the more, if they are truly a fool, the more they speak, the more trouble they get in. So there comes a day you say, you know what? This guy, no. There's no, this guy is, it's it. The wisdom of the prudent is to understand his way. He prays it out. He counsels it out. He seeks advice it out. He seeks God. He looks at all the avenues. But the folly of the fool is deceit. That's not a godly word. A fool will guide you into a wrong way. And you better be prudent and understanding enough to be realized when you're being taken. Listen, I got taken. I've been taken many times in my life by a fool. There's another fool. Fools make a mark at sin. They make fun of it. They mock it. They tell how great they have sinned. How wonderful it is that they drank. How wonderful it is, whatever they do. They never repent of the sins unless they get caught. Other than that, it's joking, it's praising, it's mocking. How wonderful that is not. But among the righteous, opposite of fool, there is favor. Matthew 2:16. How a man treats sin is how God treats man. That's a profound statement. Your attitude towards sin is how God will treat you. Aren't we told we're to hate it? We are told. We've read it. Then why is this guy a fool mocking? The heart knoweth his own bitterness, and a stranger does not intermeddle with his joy. Isaiah 53:3. Now this you need to get. You need to understand this. Save the lost. Only you can know your heart's feeling. Do not expect others to know. This is like pain. No one understands what you're going through. And they cannot. Don't blame your wife. Don't blame your husband. Don't blame your pastor. They don't know what you're going through. You can have a broken leg. You know how many possibilities of pain and things that can go with a broken leg that maybe someone's never suffered. Maybe someone's never even had a broken leg. I've never, praise God, and don't ever want a broken bone in my body. Never. So if I know somebody who gets a broken bone and they're I don't know what it feels like. I have gone through a boil, a rather large one. There are people who never had boils. They don't know what it's like. They don't know how much the Bible can come clear to you when you're dealing with something like that. I have dealt with a death of a wife. There are pastors in a pulpit and they love the Lord, they never had to deal with their wife passing on. He's not going to know. She's not going to know. And you can't walk away from someone and say, well, how cold that person is. It's not being cold, it's they don't know. They would like to feel for you. And the only thing, maybe the best thing they can say, listen, I'll pray for you, and that's the only thing they can do. Alright, let me say like this. Take any man and let him try to explain to you giving birth. The actual giving birth. You think he can explain it to its fullest degree on paper or on at a podium before all, you know, imagine a man getting up to speak. I'm going to teach you, I'm going to show you about the pain in childbirth. I don't think so. How about you get a woman at the podium and has never given birth to a child? She's, no, you can't. But if you were to have a woman who has had children, especially one who just recently had a child, get up and say, boy, she can speak. And there'll be a bunch of men in the audience saying, that ain't that bad. Because they never... Do you know what the Bible calls as the greatest pain ever to be? What is God like when he wants to stress extreme pain in the Bible? A woman going into labor. As a woman that travaileth. And there are sometimes, I'll tell you what the worst words to tell somebody who's in pain or someone who's going through trouble. I know what you're going through. No, you don't. Shut up. Just shut your mouth. Now, you may have been going through the same situation, but your life and that person's life is totally different. Oh, my back hurts. Your back hurts? Well, you go speak to my wife when she showed you the MRI report of her back. And I guarantee if you were to get somebody who has a broken back, would top what she's going through. I know an evangelist who's got a very bad neck problem from a swimming accident. Always constantly in pain. And you're going to walk up to somebody like those three people I just mentioned and say, oh, I know what you're going through. And you take ibuprofen and the pain goes away in a half hour. No. So please, listen to me. Listen to me. Don't accuse the people as you are in your pain or your suffering. They don't understand. They don't care. Don't take it. They don't understand what you're actually going through. And that I'll pray for you, hopefully earnestly, that they are going to. It's the best thing they can do. It's important. The house of the wicked shall be overthrown. Within time, in eternity, it'll be overgrown. No more. But the tabernacle of the upright shall flourish. Imagine all those Jews that will be in the new earth. No sin, no pain, no sorrow. Having children like Adam and Eve were supposed to have without the fall. 2 Corinthians 5:1. There's a way. Here we go. This is going to show up a couple times in. There is a way, religion, science, education. Way is singular. Now go and read John 14:6 on that one. Jesus said, I am the way. But this says there is a way. What are the A ways? Atheism, evolution, Catholic, philosophy. They're all different, but they're all a way. So there is a way which seemeth, I am the way, the truth, and the life. There is a way which seemeth right unto a man. There are people that are involved in religion and science and whatever have you. And as wrong as they are, they are truly thinking with their heart, not head, that to whatever God, if a God, they are right. And you're not going to convert them. That's sad. For God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him shall not perish, but shall have everlasting life. But Jesus said, the few that will go in, and many will go into the way of destruction. There are people who are in hell today, and who will be in hell, and they will be surprised that they are there. There are some that will say, Jesus, didn't we do this? Jesus, didn't we do that? And Jesus will tell them, depart from me. And when they say that, it's not an excuse, but they truly, honestly believe what they were doing, as much as we should believe the Bible. There are men out there who are in a religion, as the Mormons or Jehovah's Witnesses, and they truly, truly believe in what they tell them, and to the end of their life, whatever they are told, they believe they are right. And that's sad, but that is a truth of fact. You may have a relative, you may have a friend, you may have a co-worker, you may know somebody. Why won't they turn to Jesus? Because the way they're going is right to them. There is a way which seemeth right unto men, as much as Jesus is the way for you, what they are involved in, they are right. And you're not going to change it. Matter of fact, they might even change you. Try to change you. I have not seen that yet. I have not seen anybody in a religion try to convert me over. But I leave gospel tracts out. I talk to people. I witness on the streets. And I have yet seen somebody come out with a sign on the street and say, here, eat Jesus and drink Jesus for salvation. I haven't seen that yet. I haven't seen anybody come out, drink beer and you'll be happy. But that is their way. And they believe it. But now this is not a contrast, but this is a serious but in someone's life. You have your way. Okay, I got my religion. But the end, death, when they die, thereof are the ways of death. You know, you said the end, death, there are the ways of death. Doesn't Revelation 20 speak about the second death? And that second death is being, listen, that's not, you know, no, that's not closing your eyes to death. That's that second death when you are cast into the lake of fire, Revelation 20 speaks about. That is more than taking your last breath. The way that you believe that is not Jesus Christ will lead you into the lake of fire. Now check out Matthew 7:13 on your way for the ways. Their ways. Now you can convert them. It's not completely hopeless, but for some. My grandfather was semi into the Catholic Church and he was converted. I have an aunt who was diehard into it, everything, and I doubt her salvation. I have an uncle in the same family, Polish Roman Catholics. He's died and going on, and I would say 50-50 if he's going to be in glory. I'm not saying Catholics will go to hell. Listen, they believe pretty much all we believe. They believe Jesus was virgin born and died for their sins, and they're just as saved as I am. But if their way is not Jesus Christ, we won't get into science and how they disprove God and everything, but that's a serious verse. Alright, verse 13. Even in laughter, the heart is sorrowful, no peace. And in the end of the mirth, or that mirth, is heaviness, which leads to no hope. Ecclesiastes chapter 7, verse 2. This is why we have comedy and comedians. To drown out that heaviness, that sorrow. Howard Hughes had the money, had the resources. As far as I've been told, and I haven't read his biography, and I should, since I mentioned his name, I'll understand that he did not die as a happy man. I am told that in his death, his body was not as tall as it was. He lost a lot of weight. He could have hired every comedian in the world in his time. And he could have laughed with all the laughs. But when they stop playing and you're alone on your bed. Listen, I have had times in my life I put my head on that pillow and the sorrows come. I want sleep. I want to get away from it. And they're there. And until God gives you the victory, until God gives you the glory, alcohol and pills are only temporal. They will wear off, and you better have money if you want to keep going that way. The backslider in heart.
Ooh, backslider. That's what he...
shall be filled with his own ways. Self-confidence. Mark 14:29. I'm okay. I don't need to hear preaching. I don't need the Bible. I'm okay. And a good man shall be satisfied from himself. Trust not in thy own confidence. I think lean not to thy understanding. You know? Verse 15, self-explanatory. The simple, remember him? We've been talking about him. Go back, get the videos and the audios, whichever you like, or both. Download them. The simple believe every word. The simple is a medium listener, your average American, and your public school student. Do you realize what the public school is teaching our children, that they believe every word? Do you know what the public school system is doing for damage? The simple believe, 1 Corinthians 13:7. Every word of man or God. Remember, we can't say both. You say, well, what about gravity? I mean, what man? When we get to heaven, find out that there was no such thing as gravity. Well, Solomon says that the water evaporates up to the clouds and all that, and it falls over on the. Yeah, but what if it was even simpler or more complex than that? Let's get the word from God, what he says. But the prudent man looketh well to his going. When a person is taught evolution, a prudent man will go look for the facts and find out, okay, is it really true? When the teacher writes up on the blackboard 4 + 4 = 8, a prudent man is going to, I'm going to make sure. You do know that the public school systems in America are teaching the simple stuff that are not true. You do know, let's see, I'll just mention one name to make sure. I'll mention some others, we'll move on. Do they ever teach about Michael Luther King Jr.? You may say, well, who's Michael Luther King Jr.? You call him Martin. And his name has never been any document. It has never been legally changed to Martin. You know what I grew up learning? That George Washington chopped down a cherry tree. Do you know that was wrong? That is not true. There is which I don't know the complete story too, but Betsy Ross and American flag, what I taught wasn't true. What I was taught was not true. You know, there was a time before 1492 that students sat in a room and they were taught that the world was flat. And the Bible tells you it's round and hangeth upon nothing. That's just some examples. And there are people out there, yes, I learned that from school. I learned that from school. I learned that from school. And they have been taught wrong. A wise man feareth and departeth from evil. Well, let me just go back to Proverbs chapter 1 and read you. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, but fools despise wisdom and instruction. A wise man feareth and departeth from evil. Depart, Job 28:28. Evil, reaping. You see what you mean? He's not going to do something where he's going to reap the evil. He's not going to drink and crybaby 40 years down the road while his liver is all messed up and his family's gone and he's killed a school load of kids on the highway and wasted all his money. But the fool rages, and looking for my note here, rages. Alright, rages. Just do it. I can do what I want. And is confident. I'm going to smoke the dope. Matter of fact, in some states in America now, it's legal. I don't care what people tell me about dope. I'm going to smoke it. And I realize one day their brain will be gone. And all the things they say that dope will do to your body. And then one day, you know, you do dope and all that. And then you get married one day. You're so smart. You're so wonderful. You're going to do drugs and you don't care. And one day you get married and your wife comes home and she says, "Hey, went to the doctor today. I'm pregnant." And in 9 months, when that nurse comes out with that bundle of joy, you are sweating. You are hoping that child has 10 fingers and 10 toes. You are hoping that there's no open in the belly but a belly button. You're hoping that that child is breathing properly. I can just do it. Go ahead. I can do anything I want. Have to go up to your mother and say, "You know, Mom, kind of personal, but I got this thing in an area that..." "Oh, yes, son, I know what that is. That's when your father stepped out on me one night or a weekend or a month, and he caught it a disease." But he can do whatever he wants. Just do it. And no fear. What you're going to do to people around you. No fear what you're going to do to your family. Just do it. A fool. You are a fool. And is confident. "I can do it. I can get away with it." He that is soon angry. Uh-oh. I'm touching home on this one. Soon angry. You get quick angry. Deal with foolishly. Gotta admit to that one. It's happened. And a man of wicked devices is hated. Wow, one that gets angry is dealt with a man who's wicked. No but in that one. That's an and. Never, never chastise a child at that moment. Tell the child what they've done wrong and say, "Listen," and give it time. Calm down. Cool down. And then take them, whatever room you take them in, explain to them what their sin is, why you're doing what you're doing. If you're at a light and it's red and a guy behind you toots the horn because the light is turned green and you're too busy texting or whatever you're doing, don't raise the bird, Christian. Don't give him the middle finger because that guy behind you may be your pastor. I've heard stories from a couple pastors where and the person in front of them who's their church member is flipping the bird and the pastor's right behind them. I know one pastor said he went and followed the person all the way where they were and found out why they got the royal salute. Don't get soon angry. The Bible says be angry and sin not. I think what we're going to do, I think we're going to stop right there. Let's do the next simple one. That goes with what we've just been talking about. The simple, remember him? The 18, we'll close with 18. Inherit a fortune. Not what it says. A simple inherits folly. Folly is also a word followed with foolish. He gets the con job. Troubles. He gets trouble. He gets things that don't work out. Imagine again to those simple that are in the public school system today when they're going to stand before God one day. It's going to be to their folly. There are more churches than there are schools. I, as a young boy, and I say young because I don't know how old, even though it was a Catholic church in my life, I would run to God in a Catholic church. I wasn't running to the church, I was running to God, but I associated God with a building. I didn't know any better. And as a little boy that God used it for me, I was seeking God. Why aren't these children today, if you're truly seeking God, I don't care if you run to a Presbyterian church. I don't care if you run to a congregational church. I don't care what church. If you are seeking God and not the denomination, God is obligated to give you light. You can run to the Kingdom Hall. At least they're going to teach you something about God and Jesus Christ. And you can walk into any bookstore or anywhere online and get yourself a King James Bible and start reading. You know, a church was soon to get you into a Bible. And then with the folly, back in Proverbs chapter 1, who shows up? A street preacher. Someone knocking at your door. Someone you're working with. The simple inherit folly. But the prudent, which is opposite of simple, are crowned, well, that's an interesting word mentioned, with knowledge. Crowned. You know what the simple inherit? If the prudent get a crown? A big dunce cap. You can't have those anymore. Couldn't make enough. Teacher would have to wear one. Anybody that teaches that we came from swamp gas would need a dunce cap. Anybody who teaches the Bible is not correct in the Bible, then there's no Jonah. No whale story would need a dunce cap. There's a vast difference between right and wrong again. And we'll be keeping up with these vast contrasts of good and evil all the way to chapter It ends in 19. We're getting the contract, and after that we get warnings. How simple does the Bible lay out right and wrong? It's very simple.